Father, we, your people, now position ourselves to hear your word. Speak now to our hearts and to our minds. It is our desire to leave here better than we came. We thank you for what you're going to do through your word.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
And we give you all the praise.
All the praise.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Psalm 85, I'm going to begin reading at verse number 6. Those of you that are physically able, would you stand with us in reverence and honor of God's holy word? The Bible says, reading from the English Standard Version, will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Amen.
Show us your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation.
Yes, yes.
Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people.
Amen.
To his saints. Let them not turn back to folly.
Yes, Lord.
Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him.
My Lord.
That the glory of the Lord may dwell in our land.
Amen. Amen.
I want to talk about live again.
Live again. Amen.
Live again. Thank you, ushers. Thank you to our musicians. Deacons and staff, and just a blessing to be in church today.
Amen.
Live again. Discouraged. Depressed. Distressed. Distraught. Down and out. I just described some of the feelings that many of us are going through today.
Right.
To the point that life, difficulties therein, has caused many of us to be in a position where we just exist.
Yes, yes.
But the truth is, we're not living. Did you know that you can exist and still not be living? When you have to go through major difficulty, sometimes, if we are honest, we don't always respond to adversity in a way that pleases God.
Amen.
I believe I can say with assurance that there are many of us who have allowed life to beat us up so that there have been moments where we just didn't want to live anymore. That problems can be so heavy and so burdensome that sometimes, even if it's for a moment, there are some of us who have even contemplated taking our lives. Not get too many amens there, because I know some of you think
Amen.
You can't be saved and want to commit suicide. I need to tell you, every now and then, Satan will try to trick you into believing that there's nothing else to live for.
Amen.
And I know I got some witnesses in here who can testify that I've been there, got the hat and the t-shirt, that there have been some moments in my life that I didn't think I had any other reason to live. Because guess what? Life can be hard. Even now, we dealt with homegoing service on Friday. Even when you lose a loved one, it can put you in a place of depression and discouragement, and it can put you in a place of distress when you actually feel like not going on anymore. But I want to encourage somebody that this year is the year that we stop just existing.
Yes.
And we start living. That I'm tired of just existing, and I'm tired of just going through the same old routine day in and day out. I want to live again.
Yeah.
Is there anybody here who can testify that you remember being vibrant and having vigor and living life to the fullest, but then difficulty came and it changed how you lived, and you just began to exist? You just paid bills and just ate and kept the curtains closed and just went about your day. How many of us know it's time for us to stop existing but start living again a life that pleases God?
Amen.
Because you can be saved and discouraged at the same time. You can be filled with the Holy Spirit and feel down at the same time. And I don't know about you, but it's time for us to pick up our heads, to lift our heads, to lift our spirits, to lift our hearts, and recognize we only got one life to live, and so we better start living it again and stop allowing life to beat us down and allow our problems to weigh us down. God sent me to call us to let you know that He can lift your burdens. He can lift the weight off your back. He can put a smile back on your face. It's time to live again.
Amen.
I believe our text can help us. This familiar passage of scripture, this text is written as the people of Israel have been in exile, and they come back and they see a city and a town that's literally in ruins. They understood and they understand that it was God's wrath come down upon them, and that their punishment was to be banished into exile. But God lifts His punishment and lets them back. They're able to go home, and they're back home and they see a place that's in ruins. And they look around at the hopelessness that they see. And the writer says, "Will thou not revive us again? That your people may rejoice?" Because I came to tell you, every situation that comes through in your life is not always one where you feel like rejoicing. I know I'm talking to somebody who can testify that you ain't always felt like waving your hand. That you ain't always felt like singing glory, glory, hallelujah. That you ain't always felt like getting up and shouting. That every now and then life will come and bring some stuff, but you just want to hold your head down and not say anything. Why? But God says to us, "Will thou not revive us again?" Revival that God brings, He says, will cause His people to rejoice.
Amen.
Again. When revivals come, when God causes us to live again, the first thing, and I've already said, the first thing that He does for us is He allows us to rejoice again. He says that the revival, when God breathes life back into your situation, He will also breathe life back into your disposition. And our disposition as believers ought to be a disposition, watch this, of joy.
Amen.
Somebody shout joy.
Joy.
God never promised we would always be happy.
Amen.
But He did give us joy.
Yes, Lord.
And joy that God gives us should be able to help us go through the difficult times in like.
Amen.
And even when our joy lets us down, God says, I will breathe life back into you that will cause you to be able to rejoice again.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but there ought to be somebody here who can testify, I'm tired of coming to church, sad, down, not expecting God to do anything. I need to flip the script. When I come into the sanctuary, somebody. Anybody ever had tears and they just wouldn't stop?
Yeah.
You have to find a way to get yourself that note. I want you to get yourself up and get dressed, even with the tears. Just keep wiping them as you get dressed. Put your shoes on, just keep wiping your face. Put your hat on, put your coat on. Get your knee even in the car. At the seat, just wipe your face. And say, I'm pulling my way to the house of God, and I'm going to rejoice in spite of it. Allows us to rejoice again. But then the text teaches us that not only does God allow us to rejoice again, but when God breathes life back into us, we see God's presence through His mercy. That true revival brings about a clear view of God's mercy. Because the text says, show us your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant to us your salvation.
Yes, sir.
Let me see if I can make this plain, clear, and quick. When God revives us, Sister Holmes, it's really an act of God's mercy.
Amen.
Watch this. Let me see if you get it. God can leave us as we are and still be God. He can leave us as we are and still be holy and sovereign. But God does not leave us, and I wish I had a witness right there who can shout that God does not leave us as we are. But He changes our circumstances. He changes us. And there ain't nothing but an act of God's mercy. That when we are revived and God brings life back into us, you have a different viewpoint of mercy. Because you can't be a good Christian and not thank God for His mercy. I said, you can't be a good Christian and not thank God for His mercy. Because mercy, there are two things you ought to know about mercy. Number one, mercy holds back what we deserve.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Amen.
I said, mercy holds back what we deserve. I'm going to say that one more time to somebody in the second row, the eighth row, the tenth row get it. I said mercy holds back what we actually deserve. And I wish I had somebody here who didn't mind admitting I deserved a whole lot worse than what I got. But thank God for His mercy, because I used to stand with the best of them. I used to do some stuff that I couldn't even mention in church in front of everybody. But I thank God. Instead of getting rid of me and instead of throwing me away, God's mercy stepped in and held back. I wish I wasn't by myself right there. That's why I praise Him for mercy. Because you don't know what I used to do, and you don't know what I used to be, and you don't know what I used to hang out with. But thank God that mercy stepped in. Does mercy hold back what I deserve? But mercy, let me see if you get it. Mercy is literally a manifestation of God's covenant love for His people.
Amen.
Okay. I say that mercy is a manifestation of God's covenant love. Not just His love, but God's covenant love toward His people.
Amen.
Here's why you can shout. It's because when God says, I love you, what He's saying is, I loved you yesterday. I love you today. I love you tomorrow. And I love you forever. Now listen. Y'all missing a place to shout. Let me see if I can help you. I don't know if you're going to have nowhere else to shout the rest of the sermon. Let me It's his love that causes God to keep blessing you. It's his love that causes him to keep sustaining and providing and protecting and forgiving you. When God sends a revival, he sends and allows us to see his mercy.
Amen. Amen.
But then, when God breathes life back into us and we are able to live again, not only is it evidence in our rejoicing and in mercy, but when God sends a revival, it's evidence that God is not finished with you. You pray. unsteady times, God kept me flowing in the midst of difficulty. I made it because of the calm of God. God gives peace. And when he revives us, he lets us live without worrying about the outcome of uncertain circumstances. Let's see if I can help you. When God brings life into you, here you go. You'll try to figure out when it's going to end. Because Gideon, you and I don't ever have to figure out how to solve our problems. Because God is a problem solver. God can solve and has solved every one of your problems. All you gotta do is remain steady. And if the Lord works it out by your word, praise God. But if he doesn't, I still got peace. Because I know if this situation is going to take me out, here's my peace. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If you were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, we may be also. If this situation takes me out, here's my peace. because Lazarus was dead. Disciples said, we could have went while he was sick. Jesus said, I didn't know on purpose. Because I want you to see the glory of God. Martha showed up and said, if you hadn't been here, my brother would have died. Jesus said, don't trip. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though they were dead, yet shall he live again. Let's go to the graveside. Mary shows up and says, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Jesus said, show me where you lay. Martha is standing there. Jesus says, roll a stone away. Everybody's looking around. And Martha says, he stinks by now. Why would you open the grave? He stinks. But Jesus said, didn't I tell you that you would see the glory of God? Y'all missing it. Didn't I tell you that the manifested presence of God was going to show up even at the cemetery? Take away the stone. Lazarus.
Thank you.
Come forth. Lazarus came forth. Standing up, wrapped in grave clothes. Jesus said, loose him. Let him go. But they can't stop.
Yeah.
your storm. You can testify that somewhere along the line, God had to breathe life back into you. And so now, even you might still be in it, but you can lift your hand. And you can testify, say, I still have joy. Lift your hands for somebody else and just sing hallelujah.